follow the edge which is numbered 1. So you see this is the edge and you come back. And that gives you the residue modulo the prime number that you started with. So if you remember this from the previous, from one of the slides in the beginning, we knew that this number was congruent to 2.7. So this, as you can see, that this diagram looks very nice, and you can just by looking at it, not like staring for it for 2 seconds, but if you look at it for long enough, you will find that maybe some of the properties modulo a fixed prime, you can prove those just by looking at this. But the point is, for Luca congruences, the point was that you have to prove it for all primes. So that way we cannot do it, so we have to go to this proof case by case. But the point is that if you are interested just in one prime or one prime power, then these are pretty useful. And that's exactly how we got that 7 does not divide a 0. So you can see that these are the only residues that appear, right? Following these edges, you can only go to one of these vertices, and each vertex has a number, and that's the residue where you will end up. So there is no 0 here. So 7 doesn't divide.
This Furstenberg and Deligne references, what was their context? What were they doing? They weren't doing equerry,
apparently. No, they weren't doing equerry.
What were they doing?
This was for more general. I haven't read their paper, but this was for any general sequence. Eric Crowlin and Yasami, they were able to bring it every numbers using this, and then you could use this finite state for that, but not. In fact, this function, this rational function, was only proved by Arvin Straub in 2014, so this function wasn't even there before, so we couldn't even apply it. Now there is a conjecture from 90s that of Kors and Zylberberg that all Taylor coefficients of these following functions are positive. So we know that positivity problems are usually tantalizing but pretty hard most of the times. So what can we simplify them to and see if we can get some results? So 2 years ago, Armin Straub and Zubelin showed that the diagonal coefficients of this function are actually Apri-like numbers and which are given by this. So now, question is, using the positivity, so because they are defined like this, we already know that these numbers are positive. Using this positivity and the positivity of the coefficients of this function, can we say something about the positivity of that original conjecture? And still no answer, so probably you can think about it. Okay.
So in particular, you prove the diagonal coefficients are positive?
Oh, so diagonal coefficients are given by this. Yes, so they are positive.
So this was not before, or so you proved the special case?
Oh, I didn't prove it. So these two prove it.
Yeah.
Only this one. Yeah.
So this conjecture of Kaus and Zylberberg is still open?
I think so.
Okay. But the diagonal is positive because of the end. So the diagonal coefficients?
Yeah, diagonal coefficients are positive.
And that was known before, or Straub and Zylberberg?
I think that wasn't known before. Yeah. Because they could represent the diagonal coefficients as it was just consequence of that. Yeah. Okay. So before I tell you the two approaches which sort of fail in showing Luca congruences and why we have to resort to case by case, let me tell you about some open problems that you can think about. First of all, because we are doing it case by case, so a uniform approach to show the Luca congruences for this would be really helpful. Because this recurrence, using either this recurrence relation or the fact that Apri-like numbers, they come from a differential equation. And I haven't really gone into that, but Calabria or differential equations, they all come into the picture. So if you can show the Luca congruence is using that, then you won't have to come back to this question, even if you are, even if somebody finds another sporadic Apri-like number, because you don't really need to worry about that. Dwork congruences, these are congruences, higher powers of primes, and experiments show that Apri-like numbers also have also satisfy dwarf congruences, and some of them have been proved, but most of them are still open. And same goes for super congruences. So for some of these Apri-like numbers, it's shown that super congruence is true, but not for all of them. And for Apri-like for Apri numbers themselves, it's not. Okay. Now, missing residue classes by Apri-like numbers modulo prime powers. So if you remember, we were talking about primes not dividing in a given Apri-like number. So we are just talking about zero being as a missing residue modulo prime B. So what are the other missing residue classes for all these primes? And we know that they all have to be generated by the product of all these residues. So now this sort of becomes a good theoretic question in a sense. And one can try to tackle that for these Apri-like numbers, and that's not been studied at all for any of these numbers, any of these sequences. How about existence of infinitely many distinct primes dividing the sequences? As I said in the beginning, that there are some sequences for which, for example, AB sequence, where it's been shown in 1985 that all the sequence, all the primes of the form 3 congruent to 3 mod 4, they divide all the sequences, right? So we have infinitely many distinct primes which divide it. Now, how about other primes for other sequences? Can you still find an infinite list? Is this true for other sequences as well, that you can always find an infinite list of primes dividing or not dividing? Either way is interesting. Relation between conjectured ratio of e to the power minus half and regular primes. So let me just tell you what regular primes are. This result of Kummer strengthened, and now they sort of know exactly, in some cases, exactly when this phenolic condition is true, to another nicer condition, and Barry Mazur and Andrew Wells, they used or they strengthened this result to prove some certain cases. In Fermat last year, but we won't even do this. Okay, so that's the thing, and we know that there are infinitely many irregular maps. Okay, so this was pointed out to us by the referee, who said that there should be, you could see if there is a relation between the ratio over here and there.
Can I ask you, did you look at the Somes recurrence? Because the Appelle recurrence, you've got to be divisible by this cube. So the Somos recurrence is a similar thing, that it's a miracle that it works. Did you look at that?
No, we didn't.
There might be some relationship. I mean, your techniques might apply to some Somos sequences.
Okay. So why I'm talking about this question about infinitely many primes dividing the sequence is because even though this connect is still open, even though we don't know that there are infinitely many regular primes, maybe we can show that there are infinitely many primes which divide it. And we can already so see it in one case that it's true. Okay. And the other referee pointed out to us that there could be a modular form F, whose paired Fourier coefficient is related to p square, modulo p square, to this eta sequence, where we showed this congruence where p is, it's 0 if p is not 1 or 3 or 4 or 8 modulo 15. So only in that case. But we did that only for the eta sequence. So maybe for other sequences also there is such a congruence, and maybe for those as well you can relate them to modular forms. So that question is still something that worth investigating. And the last question, of course, is the non-list still. Is the non-list complete or not? And now I will just tell you why the two other approaches you could think of using for Lupa congruences don't work. And we have to come back to this case by case.